Jonna Doolittle Hoppes is an author and a journalist. Ms. Hoppes represents the Doolittle family at air shows across the country and is a popular speaker at libraries and air museums. Her articles have appeared in the Smithsonian's Air and Space magazine as well as other publications. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Jonna Doolittle Hoppes.
Just tell you a little bit of history on why I wrote the book. In the year 2000, the author and historian C.V. Glynnes passed me a copy of the original script to the movie Pearl Harbor. Or in the first script, the character of Jimmy Doolittle had been portrayed as a foul-mouthed, not-so-bright Patton stereotype. And I'm going to start off with a disclaimer right off the bat, because we got a hold of Disney, and they worked with us to clean up at least the portrayal of Doolittle. But I learned something in the course of that effort with Disney that really disturbed me. The first thing was that once someone is gone, they become a part of public domain, and you can't libel them. So you can write or say anything you want. But even more disturbing than that was the fact that the kids writing movies and scripts today really didn't have a clue on who Doolittle was in particular, or really on our history. So I decided to write a book to put my grandparents back out there, but I wanted to be a little bit different from the other things that were out there. So I told the stories the way my grandmother told them, which were just not quite as cavalier as my grandfather might have told them. December 7th, 1941, Pearl Harbor was attacked by the Japanese. President Roosevelt asked that we retaliate against the islands of Japan. And less than 4 months later, Jimmy Doolittle led a raid on the homelands of Japan. He led 80 men and 16 airplanes off the USS Hornet. It was the first joint task force between the Army Air Corps and the Navy. There are myths that surround the raid. One of the myths is the fact that it was my grandfather's idea. It's not true. The idea for the raid actually was presented by a Navy fellow, a submariner by the name of Captain Lowe. He came up with the idea as he flew over an airfield that had the outline of an aircraft carrier, and he wondered if we couldn't take a medium land-based bomber off an aircraft carrier. The message was elevated to Admiral King. Admiral King called Hap Arnold, and General Arnold called in my grandfather. Now, what made Gramps uniquely qualified for this particular mission is the fact that he had his doctorate of science from MIT in aeronautical engineering, the first one ever issued. So it wasn't Granddad's idea, but Granddad was asked to come up with an airplane. And he narrowed it down to just one airplane that could really take off an aircraft carrier, and that was the B-25. You see, when you look at this, all of the airplanes took off from exactly the same spot because there was only 6 feet between the wingtip and the island, and 6 feet between the outside wheel and the drop-off of the deck. Now, they stripped the airplanes down because the mission was going to be such a long one. So they were stripped to really just minimum weight, even taking out the tail gun. In place of the tail gun, they had two broomsticks painted black. But what they then did was they put four 500-pound bombs in those bombers, and then they put a rubber bladder of gasoline and five men. So when those airplanes took off a day early, 250 miles further off the coast of Japan than they anticipated, they took off in seas that had 30-foot swells, bombers loaded with gas, bombs, and men. Now, you often hear that the raid was a suicide mission, and that's not true. They knew the science behind it. The plan was for those planes to take off, bomb Japan, and land in China, and be turned over to the Chinese for defense of the Pacific. This is a picture of my grandfather. He's sitting on the wing of his B-25. It's in pieces. he's at one of the lowest points in his life because he thought the mission was a failure. I mean, it was his first mission. All 80 men on that task force, it was their first mission. And he knew where his crew was, but he didn't have a clue where the rest of his boys were. His crew chief, Paul Leonard, said to him, he said, "You know, boss, they're going to make you a general." And Granddad kind of looked at him and he said, "They're going to take my airplane away." And Paul said, "You know, boss, they're going to give you the Congressional Medal of Honor." And Granddad kind of laughed and he said, "They're probably going to, I'll be lucky to get a paid vacation in Leavenworth." And then Paul said to him, "You know, boss, they're going to give you another airplane. And when they do, I'd like to fly with you." My grandfather said that that was the highest compliment he'd ever been paid. Because here he was, leading this mission. He didn't know where any of the planes were. His was obviously broken. And here's this kid that wanted to fly with him. Well, Paul was right. Granddad was promoted to general. He was also awarded the Congressional Medal of Honor, which he did not feel he deserved. In fact, he told both General Arnold and General Marshall that he didn't feel he deserved it, and they outranked him, so they said he gets it anyway. And when he accepted that medal from the president, he accepted it on behalf of all of the Raiders. So anybody who knows any of the Raiders or any of the Raider families knows that the medal that is not on eBay, it's at the University of Texas in Dallas, belongs to every one of those Raiders. The mission lost three men that night. Two of them drowned when they ditched off the coast of China. One was killed when he bailed out of the plane. Eight men were captured by the Japanese. Of those eight, three were executed by firing squad, and one was starved to death. Five men landed in Russia. The plane was confiscated. The men were interned for 14 months. In fact, the Russian government used to send us a bill for their keep. The impact of the raid was psychological. It did three things. It gave the Americans the boost they needed. It made the Emperor of Japan lose face because the Japanese people had been told that no one could ever touch the homelands of Japan. And it made the Japanese change their way of defending themselves. And they pulled some of their ships back. My grandfather used to say that we were all put on this earth for a purpose. And that purpose in life was to make this world a better place in which to live. He said we could do that by painting a picture, writing a poem, building a bridge, combating injustice or prejudice, and in a thousand other ways. His story is fairly well known. But as I look around this room, I see other stories, equally as important, other stories that really should be told. And what started out for me as a mission to protect my grandparents became something a lot more important, and that is to preserve history. The reason I tour, the reason I speak, is because I'd like people in some way to record their history. It really doesn't matter if you write a book or if you go to a museum and you do an oral history that's recorded. You can even write letters to your grandchildren and tell them what you did. And I'm not just talking to you boys. I'm talking to you ladies as well. This is our history. Every piece of it is what we put together as Americans. And if we don't record it, it's lost forever. And if it's lost forever, we can't really turn to Hollywood and complain that they aren't getting it right, because it's our job to make sure it's there for them. Thank you.